Hello, I am Megan again, and this is my book, Sign Language Interpreting, Deconstructing the Myth of Neutrality, which I will be talking about again today. This is the third section, and she's talking about participation frameworks, and basically what the role of the interpreter is and how the role is stretched through different shifts in the framework. So it starts out, she talks a little bit about how in most cases when schemas for how interpreted encounters are mismatched, it's for different reasons. And so there are two aspects of the frame of an interpreted encounter, and one of them is in terms of activities and one of them is in terms of participants. And the participation framework is the foundation for a person named Goffman's concept of footing. And so footing is the alignment we take up to ourselves and others present as expressed in the way we manage the production of reception of an utterance. And so basically the interactive discourse is not as simple as each person having just one role. It kind of is more than that. It means more than that. So you know, each person represents a piece of this interaction. So, you know, people overhearing a conversation, the people that are part of a conversation, the deaf participant, the hearing participant, you know, just extra people moving around that can maybe hear what's going on or see what's going on. Everyone has a role. And so hearers can be ratified or unratified, which means that they're being expressed, they're being addressed specifically. So like a person that is overhearing a conversation but is not a part of a conversation would be unratified. And that is just basically a bystander. So the people that are supposed to be a part of a conversation are supposed to be ratified at all times. A speaker can have one or two roles, or all of these roles at the same time, and there are three main roles that a speaker has. And like for each situation, an interpreter could have one role, and then the person that they're interpreting for could have the other two roles, or you know, so on. So the first one is principal, person responsible for or committed to what is said, the person who wrote something to be read by someone else. So principal would be maybe the person that wrote a production, but is not going to be performing it or speaking it or doing anything performative with it. And then there's the author, who is the originator of the content and form of the utterance, and an example of that would be a man that reads his own poem that he wrote. So he would be both the principal and the author. And there is the animator, which is the person producing the utterances. So a girl playing as Juliet in Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. She's not the author or the principal. But she is the animator of that of the utterance of Juliet. This relates a lot to footing because a person could be delivering a message, but may want it to be clear that they are not the principal of the message. So I can imagine some situations where an interpreter would not mind maybe being the animator, but would really hate for someone to think that they were saying what was being produced. So in that way, the responsibility, the accountability for the message goes to the originator of it only. So in interpreted encounters, this all is really complex. Who is the principal, who is the author, and who is the animator, and how is that changing and rotating throughout the encounter? So, footing. There are three writers who have sort of varying perspectives on the topic. The writers are Keith Edmondson and Wadensjo, W-A-D-E-N-S-J-O. So Keith thinks that, like, for example, when asked for a clarification, an interpreter becomes the author of the message and more than just the animator, like the rest of the time. So if an interpreter is with a doctor and a deaf patient, if the doctor says something and the interpreter signs it to the deaf person, but the deaf person maybe doesn't understand what the doctor is talking about, and asks for clarification from the interpreter, but the interpreter does not ask the doctor for clarification because maybe the interpreter understands what they say to clarify to the deaf person would be taking some kind of authorship over what was said the first time. Edmondson thinks that interpreters are never responsible for the message because the utterance, the meaning is not their concern, and they are only responsible for the formulation of it, so they are only animators. And Wadensjö thinks that interpreters are not just translating machines, but that they are coordinators of communication. And she also adds some more vocab about rendition, non-rendition, lack of rendition. Non-renditions are when there are additional utterances generated by the interpreter and that originated with the interpreter. So something said completely outside of either part of the other participants in the conversation. And then renditions are when the interpreter authors the form and the content, but the utterance originates outside the interpreter. So that's basically all the time. And then a lack of rendition would be omissions of another participant's talk by the interpreter. So a deaf person expresses something, or a hearing person expresses something, but the interpreter does not interpret it. So, to compare the two cases, code switching and foot shifts include, simultaneously communication, speaking only to the doctor, trying to speak to two people at once, but in different languages. The partiality usually goes to the deaf participant. That's what she found. So she mentions that instead of only signing some things, hearing people could really benefit from hearing the facilitation of the conversation and maybe seeing what is missing, what pieces are missing to sort of make the communication a little bit more efficient. And so the footing and the non-renditions affect everyone else's schema of the interpreted encounter. So, like for example, when the hearing doctor asks the interpreter if there's a sign for an ulcer, and the hearing or the interpreter signs that question to the deaf person, even though it wasn't directed at the deaf person, but then also she doesn't answer the question. So the doctor's kind of just left like, what? What happened? So I think Metzger thinks that there could be a little bit more efficiency instead of just kind of trying to stay completely neutral and completely out of the situation. She says that the interpreter changes footing so often because they need to relay information and manage the interaction. They don't just need to sign back and forth and back and forth. I think that what she's getting at is that it's not as simple as that there's a lot more layers that goes into it. So she says that, like, or well, Gumpers actually says that they have to do this thoroughly to communicate with each participant, and code switches and footing shifts have a big impact on the encounter, and they're necessary. So she kind of leaves it like with a big cliffhanger and asks this like big question. Should interpreters recognize that they cannot help but function as a participant within an interpreted encounter, no longer strive to be a neutral, uninvolved participant, or should they recognize the paradox of neutrality and strive to minimize their influence on interactive discourse? So I assume she'll be getting to it in the next chapter. I sure hope so. Bye. So the big question for today is, does the finding that most non-renditions were directed at deaf participants show that interpreters are partial in their provision of services? What kind of influence does this have on the interaction and the participants' perceptions of interpreted encounters?